and welcome to our service today. I am Shani, the Youth Coordinator here at Cambray. Here we are, facing our third lockdown with our services back on YouTube. As I talk, we all be sitting on our sofas at home, and I imagine there can be a bit of disappointment and tiredness around, but the amazing thing is that this can still be a time in which God can continue to work in our hearts. The day after the government gave the last announcement, I was reading a book, and the first paragraph I read was saying, "We must maintain a spirit of thanksgiving." And I was like, this seems to become harder and harder at the moment. But then it continued saying that every challenge is a good opportunity for growth. And this is true. The best growth doesn't happen when everything is going perfectly well. But when we are under pressure, maybe when our dreams or plans seem to disappear, that is the moment in which God is shaping our character, making us more like Jesus. And this is the reason why we can be thankful to God. As scripture says, we are called to rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Now we are gonna worship God singing the song called 10,000 Reasons. And you know, a new year has just started, and we don't know what kind of experiences we are gonna face in the next month. But there is something that is not gonna change. And it's the fact that whatever lies before us, our hearts will always be full of reasons to worship our living God. So let's worship together.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never. Worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before, singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. Worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Worship your holy name. Bless you, time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore, forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship Your holy name.
Let's pray. Father, thank you because we can call you our beautiful Savior. Thank you because today we can affirm that we have been forgiven and that we can rejoice knowing that you have set us free. We might not know what the next month has in store for us, but we know that we can continue to sing to you and worship you for all your goodness. Thank you because in whatever circumstances we will be in, we can call to you and you will be there as a loving Father taking care of us. In Jesus' name, Amen. Those of you who know me a little bit will know that I love cooking and baking, and I also like trying to make new things, like experiment in the kitchen, but those don't always go well. But here today I got something simple. I've got some butter, and I've got some eggs and some sugar. I can show you in here. And then I've got some vanilla extract and some flour. It's a bit heavy. And the last thing, I've got some baking powder. So what do you usually do with these things? You usually make a cake, right? So now you might start wondering, is Shani gonna do like a baking lesson? Not quite. But what if I tell you that the church, our church, is something like a cake? A cake is made by different ingredients, as we've just seen. And if you take only the sugar, yes, maybe you can eat a spoonful of sugar. You might have tried sometimes, but that is not a cake. And I would suggest you to try the same thing with the flour, really. You need all these ingredients together for making a good cake. And these are all different. An egg doesn't really look like butter, does it? But when all of these are combined together, something very good comes up. And they don't look like separate ingredients anymore, but they become one. Just one thing, a cake. The same thing happens in the church. In a bit, Tim is going to talk about how in the church there are different people having different gifts, serving God in different ways, but they all work together. We all work together, becoming one. You know, you might see people doing lots of things up front in the church, but then there are lots of other people doing things behind the scene. But every single part is important for the growth of the church. So my question for you today is, what part are you playing in your church? And there is no an age limit, really. Don't think that you are too young or too old for being involved in the church. Maybe you also like cooking like me. You could make some meals for people in need, or you like music or other things. There is a place for everyone in the church to serve, whether you are very young or older. Ask yourself what your passions are, what you like to do, or ask people to tell you where they think that you can serve. Ask God. You might think you don't have nothing to offer, but God just wants a heart which is willing to serve. And if you give your heart to Him, He's not like me that I sometimes mess up with all the ingredients, but He is able to use you for His glory. Because, you know, if you take these ingredients, they can do anything by themselves, really. They need someone to put them together and to work on them to then end up with a cake. And this is what God can also do with our church. We have been giving gifts. They don't come from us because we are very good. He is the giver, and He will make us able to serve Him for His glory.
Let us pray. Father God, as we turn to You in prayer, we acknowledge You as Lord of all, Lord of our lives, Lord over all creation. In You we can have total confidence for all that we are and need in our lives. Father, we're living in times of uncertainty, with much anxiety in many people, in our families, in our streets, in our town and nation. We long to see You at work in all situations. Father, enable us, Your children, to be the means for change to happen in others' lives as well as our own. Father, we pray for our situation as a church at Cambray. Encourage each of us to be the means to encourage others. For those of our fellowship going through treatment, recovering from operations, or just feeling lonely and isolated, encourage their hearts. For our world, we pray, Father, that You will bring peace. We particularly pray for the United States in these uncertain times. May there be a peaceful transition in the administration there. For those who have been affected by the protests, may they be comforted and healing brought about in their lives. For Christians around the world experiencing persecution, may Your light and hope shine brightly for them. As we hear Your word taught to us today, Father, we ask that we would respond in ways that honour the gospel, bringing hope to a hurting world. For we pray this in and through our Lord Jesus Christ, who brought salvation to this world. Amen.
The Bible reading is from Ephesians 4, verses 7 to 16. But to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. This is why it says, when He ascended on high, He led captives in His train and gave gifts to men. What does He ascended mean, except that He also descended to the lower earthly regions? He who descended is the very one who ascended higher than all the heavens, in order to fill the whole universe. It was He who gave some to be apostles, some to be prophets, some to be evangelists, and some to be pastors and teachers, to prepare God's people for works of service, so that the body of Christ may be built up, until we all reach unity in the faith and in all the knowledge of the Son of God, and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Then we will no longer be infants, tossed back and forth by the waves, and blown here and there by every wind of teaching, and by the cunning and craftiness of men in their deceitful scheming. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will in all things grow up into Him who is the head, that is Christ. From Him the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love, as each part does its work. Amen.
I wonder if you like jigsaws. Fun for a rainy lockdown day? If you are a jigsawer, what's the hardest jigsaw you've ever done? Was it as hard as this one? Nearly 1,000 pieces, all blank. As we know, to do a jigsaw, you have to realise that each piece is part of a bigger picture. Even if each piece looks similar, actually each is different from every other. Yet, you will only understand the significance of each piece when you see how it fits into the bigger picture. And it's the same with us fitting into God's plan for God's world. In Ephesians, we've seen, chapters 1 to 3, how the church, Jew and non-Jew brought together as God's new humanity, is a sign of God's plan to bring all things together under Christ. And as we come to chapters 4 to 6, the practical outworking of God's plan, the emphasis is not on Lone Ranger Christians, but rather each believer recognizing our place, our significance, and our purpose in the big picture. And in this lockdown, situation. That's something we really need to hear. Each of us, young or old or in between, is a vital puzzle piece in God's big picture. If you like sporting analogies, it's as if we've been called up as an individual tennis player to be part of something bigger, representing our country in the Davis Cup. Or an individual golfer called up to represent Europe against the US in the Ryder Cup. You are a vital puzzle piece. But what does that mean for the nitty-gritty of church life? Well, from this passage, it means two things which relate to one another, hinging on verse 13. If verses 1 to 6 are about the unity of the church, then verses 7 to 13 are about being a serving church together, each fitting in to the big picture. Verse 7, but to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. This is why one take on Psalm 68 says, when he ascended on high, he led captives in his train and gave gifts to men. So to every person in his church, God has given grace. But here, this is not saving grace. This is serving grace. Grace gifts, as a victorious king would give to his subjects during the victory parade. That's the Psalm 68 reference. Her Majesty the Queen giving each of us a late Christmas present. Grace gifts, this word charismata, given to each for the benefit of the church. So every Christian is a charismatic Christian, if the word is properly understood. It also means, properly understood, that I am God's gift to the church. Did you know that? I am God's gift to the church. But so are you. Each of us is. Print that on a t-shirt. I am God's gift to the church. Because to each, God has given a gift. And you are that gift to and for the church. It is God's gift, not ours. It reflects his generosity and creativity, not yours. Christ apportions it. It's not like a yo sushi conveyor belt where you see what's there and you take what you want. I'll have this one, thanks. No, Christ decides who gets what. And God, through Paul, gives some examples of grace gifts here, all of them word-based, verse 11. This is by no means an exhaustive list. But we have, don't we, apostles and prophets, which may have different nuances in other New Testament books, but in Ephesians 2:20 seem to be the foundational figures upon which New Testament faith is built. That is, the Old Testament prophets and the 12 apostles, with Christ the chief cornerstone. But then we also have the gift of evangelists, that is, preachers of the gospel and pastors and teachers, or shepherds and instructors. Possibly talking about the same role, pastoring that involves the Bible, not just an arm round the shoulder and there. But maybe, possibly, your grace gift is not mentioned here. Maybe your gift is welcoming or organising or leading youth groups or designing things or hospitality or catering or phoning up others or music or DIY, or you have a technical or financial gifts. Whatever your gift, and we all have one, all grace gifts are given, verse 12, to prepare God's people for works of service, so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. So as we serve one another with our gifts, we grow as a church. That word prepare, sometimes translated equip, to equip God's people, is used to mean setting dislocated joints back in place. It's the same word used in Matthew 4:21, meaning mending torn fishing nets. You see, we're all gifted, but at the same time, we all need each other's gifts. We all need training. We all need equipping for works of service so that we can all be built up. That's the beautiful interdependence of church life. So yes, you are a vital puzzle piece, but equally, you vitally need the church too, so that everyone is helping to equip everyone else. That's how the church grows. Everyone serving, no passengers, everyone ministering. Every Christian is called into ministry. Not a pastor-teacher ministry necessarily, but the ministry of verse 12. We believe in every member ministry, everyone watching at home, serving in some way, if that's clearer. So the question we're challenged with, friends, is even in this strange time of lockdown and staying at home, will you be committed to play your role in the big picture, serving some way so that the church can grow? You have a unique gift, which means you have a responsibility. If you don't use your grace gifts, the rest of the church is missing out. You know, it's easy to have a spectator's view of church, especially if church has simply become watching YouTube. We watch the Sunday performance. We hope it's to our liking. You pay for it after all. But if someone offers you a role in the performance, you bolt out of the door. Well, when we gather physically or online, it's not a performance. It's not. It's a time of everyone equipping everyone else. So we can't say, oh, we're just here for the teaching, because the point of the teaching, along with every other ministry, is equipping you for making disciples in your workplace, in your home, in your neighbourhood. Otherwise, we'll be like the enthusiastic but misguided fisherman who has all the right poles, all the right nets, all the right bait, a really nice boat, but has never actually caught anything because he's never actually got into the boat and actually been fishing. That's what we're here for. There was a man who went into a pastor's office to inquire about membership, and he said he was not able to get involved or anything, but he felt it was important to have some sort of church affiliation. But the pastor advised the man that if that was the case, this church might not be the best fit for him, but he did know of a church where he'd fit in perfectly. So the man asks for a phone number, but the pastor only gave him an address. So the next Sunday morning, the man follows the directions, but he pulls up at a ramshackle, dilapidated building. Can you imagine? The roof was falling in, the doors were locked, there were weeds growing in the window, and clearly nothing was happening. No one was around. So, and I think you know where this is going, the man phones the pastor and says, oh, I think you've given me the wrong address. But the pastor replies, oh, no, not at all. That's the place. The church has a large membership filled with people who don't want to get involved, but just want some sort of church affiliation. Well, praise God, we're not quite like that ramshackle church, if you can call it that. But it is a challenge for us all to get stuck in where we can, however we can, even in the current situation. You see, God gives serving grace so that we serve and that the church is built up, disciples making disciples, building one another up. How has God gifted you? How are you using that gift? So we have a serving church, but we also in this passage have a maturing church, verses 13 to 16. Being a maturing church makes us sound like a cheese or a wine, doesn't it? But have a look with me once again at verse 13. Until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Then we will no longer be infants tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of men in their deceitful scheming. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will grow to become in every respect the mature body of him who is the head, that is, Christ. From him the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. So the reason that grace gifts are given is to build up the church, leading to maturity. This side of eternity, we will never be perfectly mature, but we must aspire to full maturity, daily growing as disciple-making disciples, building one another up. Well, what does that look like? Well, verse 14, it means that as a church, we are not like a small inflatable dinghy just tossed back and forth by the waves, blown this way and that by this teaching or that teaching, that the craftiness, the dice rolling of scheming men. This would be a church that never quite knows its own mind or never quite comes to a settled convictions. It would be a church whose opinions are based on the last book we read or the latest theological fad. I wonder if you've ever experienced a wave machine in a swimming pool. You plant your feet firmly on the swimming pool floor, but wave after wave means you're dancing about, trying to find stability underfoot. Verse 14 says, that's the immature church, unstable. But rather, if we are a maturing church, it means that we are discerning, not easily manipulated, not naive, stable, aware, because we check everything out according to the emphasis of the whole Bible in context. Not Western culture, not Cambray tradition, but ready, willing, and stable. But a maturing church also, verse 15, speaks the truth in love, growing up into Christ, building itself up as each part does its work. It's easy to think of the phrase speaking the truth in love to mean a church that calls a spade, but says it politely. But actually in Greek, there is no verb to speak here. It is more literally truthing in love. The signs of a maturing church are both truth and love, truthing in love together. Both are indispensable. If church was only about truth, not love, can you imagine? Our Sunday gatherings would be piped information, barked out from the front, take it or leave it doctrine, no role models, no accountability, no tears, no laughter, no relationships with one another, no vibrant experience of the Christian life. Truth becomes hard if it's not softened by love. But if church was only love, not truth, it would just be chatting over lattes on Zoom, talking about ourselves, no common theology, never saying anything controversial or challenging because we certainly wouldn't be teaching from the Bible. Love becomes soft if it's not stiffened by the truth of the gospel. But God gives us both truth and love. Can you imagine this then as the direction for Cambray? Truth and love together in all we do. Each of us knowing and using our grace gifts, getting involved, every member ministry. Sunday is not primarily about the minister or the academic tickle of the sermon, but Sundays as equipping one another, the half-time team talk, as it were, prepping us for our ministries the rest of the week, recognising that the work of the ministry is in each of our hands, equipping one another for works of service, encouraging and discipling one another so that we're all built up. Can you imagine being a serving church? Every person ministry, for we all have been given grace gifts, vital to the church's growth. And can you imagine being a maturing church, ready, willing, and stable, truthing it in love? Well, let's take a moment to reflect on how, even in these uncertain times, we can serve God and serve each other, growing to maturity together. Well, it's great that you've been able to join us this morning. Do check Friday's Church e-news for details of all that's going on at midweek, including small group gatherings, what and who we can be praying for, and details of online Alpha starting 14th of January, the CAP Money course starting 26th of January, and our online Cambray quiz on the 30th of January. Directly after this YouTube service, 11:30 a.m. is a chance to gather, to chat and to pray on Zoom. Do join us to continue being church together. Well, we've been thinking this morning about how each of us is a vital piece in God's big picture. So let's end by remembering once again verse 15 and 16 of Ephesians 4. Speaking the truth in love, we will in all things grow up into him who is the head, that is Christ. From him the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love, as each part does its work. Amen and amen.